All right, so I'm going to talk about one last test for this class, and it is the chi-square goodness of fit test, and you can make that a compound adjective if you like. And you use this when you have one dependent variable that's nominal. And so what you'll have is counts of different kinds of people or observations. And the example we'll use here is we're trying to figure out if students at Southern Utah University are more likely to be a Republican than a Democrat or any other political orientation. So our example here is that SU students, our research hypothesis, they are more likely to be Republican. And the null hypothesis is going to be the dull hypothesis, where there's nothing interesting happening. And so for this, we'll say the null hypothesis is that SU students are equally likely to be all different kinds of political, to have political affiliations. So this would be a study where we have students come in and we ask them, for example, are you a Democrat, a Republican, or other? And our research hypothesis is that they're more likely to pick Republican. A null hypothesis says that they're equally likely to pick all three. Next, we'll go through the steps for a chi-square goodness of fit test. And so we'll again start with saying what our null hypothesis is. And here we'll say that we'll stick with the example we just had, which is our research hypothesis is that SU students are more likely to be Republican than other political affiliations. So our null hypothesis is that there's no difference amongst the political affiliations. All political affiliations are equally likely. The next thing we'll do is we'll look at our observed data, the data we actually get in our study. And we'll say what we have is something like Democrats, Republicans, and other. And then each person comes in and they have to say which of these they are. And so we'll say we have 20 of our participants say they're Democrats, 20 say they're Republicans, and 35 say that there's something other than Democrat and Republican. Well, so right off the bat, we can tell, well, this doesn't really fit our research hypothesis, but is this data so inconsistent with these being exactly the same with our null hypothesis that we can actually figure out that maybe our SU students are more likely to be other than Democrat and Republican? And so next we will calculate our test statistic. And for the chi-square goodness of fit test, the test statistic is a chi-square. In fact, it has the exact same formula as it did for the chi-square test for independence. So our chi-square test statistic is the sum of our observed minus expected squared divided by expected. All right, so for all of the three different observed values, we'll determine its expected values, plug those in, and add across all of them, and that'll be our chi-square value. Before we can calculate this test statistic, though, we first, again, need our marginal frequencies, just like we did for the chi-square test for independence. And here, there's actually only one margin over here. It's really our total sample size. So we have 20, 40, 75 observations that are distributed across our three different groups in our nominal variable, political affiliation. All right, we've got our marginal frequencies. Now we can use those to determine our expected frequencies. And remember, these are expected if the null hypothesis is true. So if the null hypothesis is true, then people are equally likely, students are equally likely to pick all three of these. So we would say this is our observed data. And now down here, we'll do our expected data. So we have Democrats, Republicans, and other. And we've got our marginal mean, so that'll go down here, 75. And if our null hypothesis is true, then these 75 people will have been equally likely to pick each of these three. So we got to split the 75 equally three ways. And so that's pretty easy in this case, because we just put 25 people in each group, right? And these add up to 75, and they're equally likely. So these are the expected frequencies that we would expect to see in our sample if the null hypothesis is true. So last for this is we actually go through and do the math. We're going to calculate our chi-squared statistic. All right, so chi-squared equals, I'll just put the formula again down here, the sum of our observed minus expected squared divided by expected. All right, so we'll get our first observed 20. We need to subtract the expected value for Democrats, so that's 25. We'll square that and then divide it by the expected value. All right, and so like I did on the last test, I'm going to mark those like that. And then this is summing across for all of these. So now, I'll get a different color. Our next observed value is Republicans. We observed 20 of them. We expected 25 if the null hypothesis is true. So we'll plug those in. Right? So this refers to those matching cells. And then we have one other observed value to add. So 35 is the observed value. The expected was 25. Square and put the expected down there. Right, so that's the other observed and expected values. Okay, so now we just do our math. Chi square is going to be 20 minus 25. Negative 5 is squared as 25. Divided by 25 plus 20 minus 25 is negative 5. Squared is 25. Divided by 25 plus 35 minus 25 is 10. 10 times 10 is 100. And that's got to be divided by 25. Okay. Let's see here. 25 divided by 25 is 1. 100 divided by 25 is 4. So we add all these up, and 6 is our chi-square statistic. So we've calculated our test statistic, our chi-square, and it's 6. Now we need to find out what our critical value is, so we can tell if we can reject the null hypothesis or not. Right, so this is what's our chi-squared critical. And we'll use the same table we did before, and for that again we'll need our degrees of freedom. And here, the degrees of freedom is the number of cells minus 1. And we have 1, 2, 3 cells, so 3 minus 1 is 2. So we have 2 degrees of freedom. And the more intuitive way to think about this, rather than just using the formula, is if we have Democrats, Republicans, and other, and we don't have these values set, but we know the marginal mean is 75. If we put 20 in for Democrats, we can't tell what Republican or other is. They're still free to vary. But if we put 20 in for Republican, now the other is no longer free to vary. It has to be 35. That's the only number that could make sense. So there were two numbers that were free to vary. So we had two degrees of freedom for this example. Or you could just use the formula. But either way, you get 2 degrees of freedom. And with 2 degrees of freedom, you look at the table and your chi squared critical is going to equal 5.992. 5.992. And I put this in red so that it's easier to directly compare with our test statistic. Next, we need to decide if we're going to reject the null hypothesis or not. Same strategy we've been using for all these in class. We're going to see if our test statistic is more extreme than our critical value. And if it is, we'll reject the null hypothesis. And here, 6 is more extreme than 5.992. It's actually really close, but it is more extreme. So here we will reject the null hypothesis. And we will interpret our findings. Interpret them. Right, and here, basically our interpretation would be something like SCU students are more likely to have a political affiliation of other than Democrat and Republican. I wanted to point out that if we would have had a test statistic less extreme than our critical value, we would have failed to reject the null hypothesis like we have in the past, and our interpretation again would have been that our study was inconclusive. We couldn't really decide much about the world given our findings. And also, if you're going to use a statistical program to do these kinds of tests, which is in practice what everybody does, right? Just like with all of the other inferential tests, to decide if you're going to reject the null hypothesis or not, your statistical program will tell you a p-value, and you'll compare that with your alpha, and if your p-value is smaller than 0.05, then you reject the null hypothesis, and you'll always come to the same conclusion as you would comparing the test statistic with the critical value. And that is the last inferential test that we're going to talk about in this class. Bye.